The second scientific session carries the theme, the diabetic athlete. And this session is sponsored by the Faculty of Science and Sport at the University of Technology, Jamaica. We have two presenters during this session, Dr. Evon Berry and Ms. Sophia Brown. Each presentation will be for approximately 10 minutes, which will be followed by 5 minutes for questions. So, without further ado, we'll go right into our first presentation. Our presenter, Dr. Evon Berry, is a consultant obstetrician and gynecologist at the Victoria Jubilee Hospital. He's an associate lecturer in the Faculty of Medical Sciences at the University of the West Indies. He has special interest in minimally invasive surgery and lifestyle-related health issues. He did his high school education at Happy Grove and Titchfield High Schools in Portland. Then he went on to do a Bachelor of Sciences degree, majoring in biochemistry and microbiology at the University of the West Indies. He then went on to do his medical training at the University of the West Indies, completing his Bachelor of Medicine and Bachelor of Surgery degree. He then went on to do the Doctor of Medicine degree in obstetrics and gynecology at the University of the West Indies. Dr. Berry is an avid sports fan, an ardent supporter of track and field, a former footballer also, and presently manages a football team in St. Mary, in Portland, I beg your pardon. So without further ado, I'll invite Dr. Berry to come to the podium and present to us gestational diabetes and exercise. Please put your hands together and welcome Dr. Berry. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Gyles, and good afternoon. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to share some thoughts with you. And in the interest of time, I'll get right into my presentation. Now, what is gestational diabetes? It's really glucose intolerance or hyperglycemia of first onset or first recognition during pregnancy, and it affects about 15 to 18% of patients. And the prevalence of this condition is actually increasing in proportion to the increase in diabetes and the incidence of type 2 diabetes in our populations. Pregnancy in itself is a diabetogenic state because there are certain anti-insulin factors which include human placental lactogen, progesterone, cortisol, placental growth hormone, and tumor necrosis factor alpha that actually act antagonistically against insulin. Now, this increase in insulin resistance allows a high level of glucose in the mother and hence allows transfer to the fetus. Now, gestational diabetes results when the insulin secretion from the pancreas is inadequate to overcome this resistance. Now, gestational diabetes is associated with a range of adverse pregnancy outcomes that can affect the mother, the developing fetus, and the newborn. And there are also long-term complications that affect the mother and the child. It arises primarily in the second half of pregnancy, around about 24 to 28 weeks. And these are some of the short-term effects on the mother. She's at increased risk of preeclampsia, increased risk of polyhydramnios, which is excessive fluid around the baby. She's at risk of preterm labor, and she's also at risk of trauma at the time of delivery. And there's an increased risk of the mother having a cesarean section. Long term, she's at risk of having diabetes, that's overt diabetes later in life, because usually gestational diabetes clears after pregnancy. But some people in the United States estimates as much as 40 to 50% of patients are said to develop type 2 diabetes after having had gestational diabetes in a pregnancy. She's at risk of the metabolic syndrome also. Now for the fetus, there are anthropometric abnormalities, and the main one that we find is macrosomia, meaning that the child is very large. And in our jurisdiction, we use 4 kilograms and above to describe an infant that is macrosomic. She's also at risk of preterm delivery, whether by choice or it occurring as a pathological thing, because sometimes we have to do premature deliveries in the interest of the mother or child. Now, there's also risk of trauma to the baby, and the main thing that you might have heard about is shoulder dystocia, because this is one of the main complications when you have a large fetus. There's also a risk of a stillborn fetus. In the newborn, the problems don't really end at birth, but the child that is just born is at risk of having hypoglycemia because their levels of insulin are very high, and now you have withdrawn their supply of glucose from the mother when you deliver and clamp the cord. The child is at risk of hypoglycemia, hypomagnesemia, hyperbilirubinemia, which can result in neonatal jaundice, and the child is also at risk of respiratory distress syndrome. Long term, the offspring is at risk of developing obesity, developing diabetes, and the metabolic syndrome. And these all health conditions usually repeat themselves across generations. What are the risk factors? A mother of advanced maternal age, a woman who has a previous history of gestational diabetes, a woman with a body mass index greater than 25, or if there's excessive weight gain in pregnancy, if she has a history of diabetes or a family history of diabetes, if she had an infant that was macrosomic or a child who had congenital malformations, or if there was a history of an unexplained stillbirth. A woman who has multiple gestation, twins and upwards, she's at risk. A woman who has polycystic ovarian syndrome, she's also at risk of developing gestational diabetes. And there's some connection with your ethnicity, because there's a group of Indians in Arizona, the Pima Indians. They're said to have a prevalence rate of about 40%. Now, what are some of the strategies that we can use to prevent gestational diabetes? Now, some of these, diet has been tried, exercise, which is the one that we'll focus on today, metformin, which you know is used to treat diabetes, and there are some novel interventions like the use of inositol. Now, if the evolutionists would have their way, they would say if we don't correct our lifestyle problems, then this is what the evolutionary pathway that man might take. So, where do we start? Maybe we should get rid of the weapons of mass destruction, right? And that will put us a long way in preventing diabetes. Now, the aim of these dietary interventions is to prevent maternal hyperglycemia and to attenuate the insulin resistance of pregnancy so as to prevent gestational diabetes. And there's a talk about the diets that have a low glycemic index and high glycemic index. We'll look at that a little later on. Exercise as a strategy. Now, this can help to reduce the patient's risk by addressing the pre-pregnancy weight and weight gain during pregnancy. And it serves also to reduce the level of adiposity and increase lean muscle mass. It causes physiological changes which favor an increase in insulin sensitivity. Now, there are certain factors that might limit physical activity in pregnancy, and that is the main concern of most mothers if you should ask them to exercise during pregnancy. Because the hormonal changes of pregnancy result in laxity of the joints, which make them hypermobile, so the patient is at risk of injury. There's also anatomical and physiological changes that occur in pregnancy that will limit the tolerance of exercise during pregnancy. Because if you consider that gravid uterus getting bigger, especially in the latter part of pregnancy, it actually prevents the diaphragm from adequately expanding. Now, if she has pre-existing disease, this might be exacerbated in pregnancy if she develops an exercise program. And also, there are certain pregnancy events that might prevent the lady from getting involved in exercise. Now, these are some of the things that are allowed in pregnancy, and I'll be going very fast through this slide in the interest of time. Basically, we try to avoid contact sports, right, or any high-impact sports in which there's a risk of loss of balance to the patient. So definitely, you would not see a pregnant woman being involved in this type of exercise. Now, what's the link between physical activity and disease? Now, when the patient is inactive, she loses muscle mass, there's increased abdominal adiposity. This leads to a chronic inflammatory process, which results in insulin resistance, tumor growth, and impaired bone function. And ultimately, the patient is at risk of developing lifestyle diseases, type 2 diabetes, cardiovascular problems, cancer, and osteoporosis. Now, there's emerging evidence that adipose tissue and muscle are no longer seen as playing a passive role in the body's metabolic function, but they are now seen as endocrine organs. Adipose tissue is said to secrete substances which are anti-inflammatory adipokines and pro-inflammatory adipokines that modulate inflammation and insulin resistance. Obesity induces insulin resistance by resulting in part from an imbalance in the expression of these pro- and anti-inflammatory adipokines. So when there's a predominance of the pro-inflammatory adipokines, then that results in insulin resistance. Pedersen et al. In 2003 suggested that there are also cytokines or other peptides that are produced by muscle tissue that actually work against these adipokines, and this would favor increasing your insulin sensitivity. 2 minutes, wow. Okay. All right, I'm just going to flip through these in the interest of time. Now, the question is, can exercise prevent diabetes, or what is the impact of exercise on its management, and how does it affect outcomes? And we'll look at some studies that have been done. Now, there's evidence to suggest that exercise can help in improving glycemic control. One study by De Barris et al. Looked at the effect of resistant exercise program on insulin requirement and glycemic control in patients with gestational diabetes. There were 64 subjects, which were equally divided into 30 in the exercise group and 32 in the exercise group and 32 in the group that didn't exercise. And the results showed that there was a significant reduction in the number of patients requiring insulin in the exercise group, where only 7 out of 32 patients required insulin, as against 18 out of 32 in the control group. This was another group, Gabriel et al., actually attested to the same thing, but they had used exercise in women who were overweight with gestational diabetes. Now, how does it affect pregnancy outcomes? Barakat et al. Examined the effect of regular moderate intensity exercise on the incidence of gestational diabetes as a primary outcome, and also the effect on adverse pregnancy outcomes, such as macrosomia, risk of cesarean section, and maternal weight. And from the findings, they found that there was no reduction in the risk of developing gestational diabetes. However, there was a 58% reduction in the risk of macrosomia, meaning an infant larger than 4 kilograms. And there was also a 34% reduction in the risk of cesarean section. The maternal weight gain was also 12% lower in the exercise group, independent of whether the woman developed gestational diabetes. Now, the evidence to support exercise being used as a preventative measure for gestational diabetes. Tobias et al. Reported in a study that pre-pregnancy exercise resulted in a 55% reduction in the risk of gestational diabetes, and that exercise during pregnancy, in early pregnancy, resulted in a 25% reduction. Now, the Cochrane Review, this is a well-respected review panel out of the UK, they actually did a meta-analysis of studies that looked at exercise in pregnancy. And it was they looked at randomized controlled trials assessing the effect of physical exercise in developing pregnancy glucose intolerance. And they excluded women with pre-existing type 1 and type 2 diabetes. Now, the finding from this study showed that there was no significant effect on preventing gestational diabetes, however, and it actually showed an increase in cesarean section rate, even though it was of borderline significance. There was no significant difference in operative vaginal delivery, meaning the use of forceps or vacuum extraction, and there was no significant difference in other maternal and fetal outcomes. Now, what the trial found was that the meta-analysis showed that these trials had very small sample sizes, which could have affected the power and also there was significant bias, and also the performance bias. It was not easy to avoid because to allocate people as to exercise or not, you were relying on a historical report from the patients. It might have not been accurate. And there was also a high attrition rate in the studies. Okay, now in conclusion, there's limited and incomplete evidence from randomized trials assessing the effect of exercise in preventing gestational diabetes. And currently there are 7 randomized trials, so we await the findings of these trials before we can put this to clinical practice. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Berry. We can perhaps take maybe 2 questions. There are the microphones in the passageways. First question, yes?
For females with gestational diabetes, yeah, postpartum, the diabetes goes away. But what is your advice to these women with respect to their own risk for overt diabetes later on in life? What's your advice?
Well, the advice is regular screening, right, by their primary care physician. Because upon discharge from hospital, we usually advocate that at 6 weeks, we do some form of glucose tolerance testing, and that at least every 6 months or yearly that they get screened. Right? And also, based on the evidence that we have, we would also recommend that they do some form of physical activity, because some of the slides that I had not gotten time to go through shows the connection between losing adipose tissue, because we said that the adipokines are produced by the adipose tissue that actually increase your insulin resistance, but by exercising, the myokines will negate the effect of those adipokines. So certainly exercise and regular monitoring and follow-up is the way to go. Does that answer? Okay, thanks.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Berry. Our next presenter is Ms. Sophia Brown, a physical therapist, adjunct lecturer in the Department of Physical Education at the Mico University College in Kingston, Jamaica, a member of the Jamaica Physiotherapy Association and the Jamaica Association of Sports Medicine. Ms. Brown did her training in physiotherapy at the University Hospital School of Physical Therapy at the University of the West Indies. She did a bachelor's degree, a diploma, and a master's degree in sports and exercise medicine. She also did a postgraduate diploma in education at Northern Caribbean University. Ms. Brown has interests in investigating the incidences of sports, of injury in sports, and the rehabilitation processes from a physical therapist's perspective. At this time, she'll be presenting to us on the diabetic athlete, a higher risk for injury or prolonged rehabilitation, she asks. Please put your hands together and welcome to the podium, Ms. Sophia Brown. Thank you.
I'd like to thank the organizers of this conference for inviting me to present in this forum. Thank you. All right, so let's go right in. All right, we'll now look at we'll look in this presentation at the overview of diabetes mellitus, the benefits of exercise in our sports in type 1 diabetes mellitus. I'll give you the purpose of this review, the background to this review, and my results and findings, and then I'll conclude. Thank you. The overview is that diabetes mellitus is a chronic endocrine disorder characterized by hyperglycemia or high blood sugar. There are 2 types, types 1 and 2. For purposes of this presentation, I will be speaking on type 1 because that is what is most present in our elite athletes. Normally, type 2 would vanish with exercise at that level. The type 1 is more common in schools and professional athletes, and type 2 is extremely rare in competitive athletes. Competitive sports actually are generally safe for anyone with type 1 diabetes in a good metabolic control and without any long-term complications, the neuropathy, and the retinopathy. The glucose response to exercise is affected by factors such as the exercise intensity, how hard you exercise duration, how long you exercise, the time of the day you exercise, environmental conditions, whether it's hot, cold, in between, emotional stress, whether you're in competition or outside of competition, or if you're excited, and the absorption rate of insulin that you have and the amount of dietary supplements that the athlete is taking. Effective management, therefore, is for each athlete. It is individualized, and it must consider the typical demands of your training, competition, depending on your sport, the goals of the athlete, the factors related to sports participation that may affect glucose homeostasis, safety of athletic participation, contact versus non-contact sports, adequate monitoring of your blood glucose level, possible adjustments to your diet and insulin to allow safe and effective athletic performance. Diabetics participating in quick action sports should be careful about injuries that may occur as a result of the reaction time that you need in order to compete. The blood glucose levels that are recommended is on the screen, 100 to 180 milligram per deciliter, or 5.5 millimoles per liter, up to 10 millimoles per liter during practices, games, which allows your athlete to compete in a safe, effective manner. In the type 1 diabetic athlete, there should be absolutely no exercise if this is above 15 millimoles per liter and is equivalent, because what will happen is that the hyperglycemic state will cause your body to use glucose not as efficiently as it should, so it would break down fat, creating ketone bodies, and these, over a period of time, will end up becoming toxic and creating ketoacidosis, which is a medical emergency. Are the main benefits of exercise in the type 1 athletes is that it increases skeletal muscle mass, which makes them more bulkier and able to be stronger and more powerful. And it improves the insulin sensitivity, thereby causing an exercise-mediated enhancement in their metabolic control. The background continues with 347 million people worldwide being diagnosed with diabetes, and it is expected to be the world's seventh largest leading cause of death by the year 2030. And out of that number, we will expect, based on what is happening now, that 10 to 15% of the population will account for type 1. What pretty much happens is that type 1 diabetics are not always observed to have poor metabolic control. And so what needs to happen in an athletic population is that the level of HbA1c be monitored, and this is expected to be below 5.7% at any given time. And this is a measure of how well controlled the diabetic person, or athlete in this case, is. The management of athletes demands of physical activity and competition, therefore, requires a good balance between hypoglycemia, the blood sugar going too low, being euglycemic, normal, or going into hyperglycemia. This paper will present how hyperglycemia, hypoinsulinemia, the presence and absence of specific hormones, how those play key roles in muscle growth, are causing muscle to atrophy, which is get smaller, shrink, and impair growth in these cases. So the purpose is for us to check the incidence, if there is any greater risk for muscular injury being a type 1 diabetic, and I'm speaking specifically of strains, which is a discontinuity in muscle fibers, or if the rehabilitation process of these injuries is slower than in the normal population. What I found was that there were no direct studies in the incidence, to give me the incidence or the prevalence of strains in the diabetic athletes, and that diabetic athletes were who with poorly controlled blood glucose and insulin levels are tend to be and are associated with pathological complications such as diabetic skeletal muscle disease or myopathy. So the type 1 diabetic muscles tend to be tend to have contractile or exercise capacity is not normally affected greatly when they are well controlled. There tends to be an increase in the relative percentage of glycolytic or fast twitch muscle fibers and glycolytic enzyme. And these are the muscle fibers that we need for quick bursts of activities, jumping, running to the end, that kind of thing. Prior to neuropathic complication, type 1 diabetes mellitus fibers have reduced size loss. The repair of skeletal muscle following injury is impaired generally in the type 1 environment, and there's also a possible neural component to the impaired muscle function. They are more susceptible to contraction-induced damage, knowing that the overall health of the skeletal muscle is also affected by recovery from repeated microtrauma resulted from routine contractile activity and microtrauma from less frequent injury, thus impairment in the repair process. And this is because from day to day, as athletes train or go about, they do have small traumatic injuries to the muscle, which is the case with all persons. With the diabetic nerves, when you tend to have long-standing type 1 diabetes, diagnosed diabetes mellitus, there tends to be changes with your motor neurons, which are the nerves that come to allow you your muscles to contract and to function, and also at the neuromuscular junction where the nerve sends a signal to the muscle so that you're able to respond. In that case, reaction time, any player's ability to respond quickly, properly and precisely to information being sent is of utmost importance in determining success in any chosen sport. Now, what does trauma does, or what will it do in the case of a strain? It can cause hypoglycemia, stress hormone release such as cortisol, growth hormone, and other, which will tend to impair the wound or any fracture in the case of a bone injury. So hyperglycemia, hypoinsulinemia, the presence or absence of any kind of hormone can impede the rehabilitation process. The generalization has been recommended in the management of injuries which are prolonged for type 1 or type 2. There are no specific ways for us to go about treating a type 2 athlete as opposed to a type 1, so it follows through. So the major factors, therefore, in helping with repair or rehabilitation is the level of hyperglycemia. It should be normal, not hyper. Hypoinsulinemia, if that's too low, you'll have problem. And if the level of hormones is in excess of what they should be, then it affects how the athlete will be rehabilitated. Hyperglycemia tends to affect cognitive function, so your mental speed and mental flexibility will get less because of the nerve changes. There are chemical changes in your nerves and damage to your blood vessels that bring the nutrients to and from the damaged area. It impairs the nerve's ability to transmit signals. The proteins can undergo a process of glycation, which is the process of reduction of sugars, resulting in the chemical modification of proteins, and that will affect our type 2 muscle fibers. Motor neuron changes occur, as we said before, and also changes at the neuromuscular junction. There can be axonal degeneration of the nerves, which will, over time, delay motor nerve conduction velocity and increase your reaction time. The effect of insulin is that it's capable of activating protein synthesis through insulin supplementation, and that doesn't always follow. It inhibits skeletal muscle protein degradation, which is increased in that type of diabetes. It improves muscle mass, and particularly glycolytic fibers that undergo the most severe changes. Now, our hormonal factors effects are that it, in long-standing diabetes, it keeps going over and over. All these effects tend to affect one thing, but I look at cortisol, which promotes a negative protein turnover and is generally elevated above normal in type 1 diabetes mellitus. This, though, may be related to the disease duration and also stressors such as exercise, so it causes a negative effect. In concluding, our type 1 diabetic athletes can compete safely in sport, even contact sport, and therefore can get injuries that require physical therapy rehabilitation. The sport injuries nor treatments have not been well studied in this population and warrants further investigation. There are no direct research that address the issue of blood glucose control and insulin therapy for the common athletic injuries, which in this case I looked at was strains, and the guidelines for non-critical patients from the American Diabetes Association for blood glucose control can be applied to injured athletes with diabetes. It is also obvious that individual blood glucose management protocols should be developed for each athlete before, during, and even after injury recovery. An athlete should have a glycosylated hemoglobin assay 3 to 4 months to assess, every 3 to 4 months to assess the overall long-term glycemic index. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Brown. And we'll now open the floor for one or two questions. First question.
Thank you very much, Ms. Brown. That was an excellent presentation. I have a question. How effective is the management of athletes in Jamaica?
I think we're effectively and efficiently doing that here. I've had one in the last 10 years, and he was rehabilitated well as an elite football player. So that's good, and my colleagues have been able to do that when we do get these cases.
Okay, I have another question. At what stage do we manage these athletes? Is it from the high school?
From
and then another thing, like Osafa Power, do we have insight to what is the problem about his injury? Is it that it was too much exercises, or was it that it wasn't properly managed? You know, there are questions. So
specifically with each injury, there are, and degrees of injury, there are ways for us to be able to manage them properly. As it relates to when we start, specific to diabetic athletes, we are supposed to be doing pre-participation physicals, which would pick up very early, initially, what the problems are, especially as it relates to muscles and bones and flexibility and strength with our athletes. So that way, we're able to manage and monitor them properly. So if in the beginning, someone is diagnosed with type 1 diabetes, we're able to monitor, manage, and control them. We're well equipped here to deal with that.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. We have two more persons with questions. We'll take.
All right.
Perhaps I should have asked you just to introduce yourself before you ask your question. But question and then question.
My name is Carlton Phillip from the Diabetes Association of Trinidad and Tobago. My nephew had what we call pre-diabetes. His sugar fluctuating up and down. He represented Trinidad and Tobago at the under 17 football tournament and the under 19 football tournament. He played for Trinidad and Tobago 30 times. And at age 30, he, in the army, he went for his compulsory medical 3 weeks ago. The doctor said, well, he's in the pink of health, everything all right. And 2 weeks after playing football, he dropped dead from a heart attack. And that is how it is with all the exercise, physically fit, and yet he died. Thank you.
I'm very sorry to hear what happened to his nephew in the end. But we, these days, with the endocrinologist and all of the specialist areas that we do have, we should be able to prevent such events as that, because a sequelae of type 1 diabetes and type 2 is that you can end up having cardiovascular problems. So, but we should still be able to manage and monitor our athletes efficiently.
Thank you. Final question.
Good day, my name is Romel. I was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes at age 2. I'm from the Diabetes Association of Trinidad and Tobago. My question is, if you're a diabetic, well, I play cricket, and your glucose is not properly controlled, does injuries take longer to heal?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the end. If your injury is not properly controlled?
If your glucose is not properly controlled, do injuries take longer to heal?
Yes, it does. Based on the evidence that I have, it does. Because it is very important for your blood glucose level to be controlled properly in order for you to heal properly and efficient in the time period that it would be, it would take a normal athlete to heal. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, listeners, audience, and special thanks to both our presenters, Dr. Evon Berry and Ms. Sophia Brown.